Welcome to the Christian House of Prayer's midweek service. Tonight's message comes from the series entitled Faith, the Medium of Exchange, from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb.
If you would join me now for Mark's Gospel, chapter 11. Mark's Gospel, the 11th chapter. Stand for the reading of God's Word. Mark's Gospel, chapter 11. This is the year 2010 where I'm in 2010. Not just in 2010, but we are into what we are into. And if any man be in Christ Jesus, old things are passed away and all things become new. If you are in him, then get in him. Go all the way in him. Paul, the apostle that God used to write over half the New Testament in the book of Philippians, Paul says, I want to know him and the power of his resurrection. But the flip side, also Paul says, in his suffering. Are you hearing me? It's about really knowing the God that knows all about us. Acts chapter 17, verse 28 is our foundation scripture for this year. For it says, for in him we live and move and have our being. In him we live. And Jesus said in John's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 10, he said, the thief come not but for to steal and kill and destroy. Then Jesus said, then I come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. So when we speak about for in him, we're talking about the essence of Christian living. That's what God wants you to experience in your walk with God. If you're a Christian, he wants you to experience the essence of that quality and kind of living. Can I hear the church say amen, amen?
Amen.
And?
Amen.
And the essence of Christian living, essence is the vital part, the essential part. It's the most important part. If you remove this part out, you no longer have whatever it is that it's supposed to be. So Christianity, the essence of Christianity is Jesus, is grace, and it's giving. If you take out Jesus, you know you don't have Christianity, because Christianity is Christ in me. Man, this is good. The hope of glory. Say it. Christ in me, the hope of glory. If you don't have that, you don't have Christianity. If you don't have Christ in you. And then also grace. If you don't have grace, you're not saved. For it's by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It's the gift of God. So Jesus, grace, giving. Those three components make up Christian living. If you don't have giving in your life, you are so much like God when it comes down to you being a person of love and a person of giving. If you take giving out of Christianity, you no longer have Christian living, because the essence of our lifestyle, God so loved the
world
that he did what? He gave. And if you're not in a giving spirit, then you don't have Christian living. Now, today I want to talk about the medium of exchange. Mark chapter 11, verse 22, 23, and 24. Are you there?
Yes,
you should have found your place by now. If you're not there, we're going to have a real problem today. Verse 22, Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Verse 24, therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Now give three people a high five. Tell them it's all about him. You're in the Christian house of prayer. Come on, it's all about him. It's all about him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's all about him. This is a renewal for so many of us here at the Christian House of Prayer. It is essential and most important for me to emphasize the reason why I'm going to Mark chapter 11, 22, 23, and 24, because as we talk about giving, and we have been talking about that since the beginning of the year, because I told you prophetically, I speak the truth and lie not, the Holy Ghost bear my conscious witness that God has spoken this to me and has given this to me and said that many of you, we're already living in the zone that I'm talking about. You're already living in this zone. It's God's zone. You know, every city, it has zones. Business zone, residential zone. This is the God zone. I told you that. And in the God zone, your broke days are over. If you are a sower, your broke days are over. Now, it would be remiss of me as a gospel preacher not to share with you what I'm talking about, and that is faith, the medium of exchange. Faith, the medium of exchange. Write this down as an ancillary verse of scripture that supports the premise from where I'm coming from, and that is in the book of Philippians chapter 4 and the 15th verse. Paul speaking, and Paul says that no church communicated unto me outside of the church he was referring to and that he was talking to. He says, apart from you, no church, watch this, communicated unto me concerning giving and receiving. Concerning giving and receiving. See, these two things go together. Faith is a two-sided coin. It's not just giving by faith, it's also receiving by faith. And so it is incumbent upon me as the pastor to teach the people how to be receivers. If you teach them how to be givers, then you have to teach them how to be receivers. Because see what we have Christians who say, I am a believer. I believe this, I believe that, and so forth and so on. But we need to be taught also how to be receivers. And this is what I want to talk to you about, because if you are a person that's going to operate based upon the economy of God in the God zone, in God's zone, if you are a person that's going to function and operate in the zone of God or the economy of God, see, the way this economy and the way the world operates, period, wherever you go on this planet, if you're going to operate and function in any form or fashion, it's going to take M-O-N-E-Y, not M-O-M. It's not going to take your mama, it's going to take some money. Hello, now your mama may be the one that you've been calling to get some. I'm getting no help already. All right, now you done already started it. I'm feeling like Mr. Rogers. I wasn't going to get in your neighborhood, but I'm going to get in your neighborhood, come down your street, your boulevard, knock on your door, ring your bell. You may not answer, but I know you're home. I'm going to talk to somebody this morning, because we're dealing with the economy of God. And the same way that the economy of the world, the medium of exchange is money. Money is the medium of exchange. If you want this, you got to have that. Yes, sir. Man, I'm already preaching good. I don't care what you do. You can't even take a putt tent and put it out on the lawn somewhere because the land is owned by somebody else. They want you to pay rent even on that. But Bishop, the earth is the Lord's in the fullness thereof. I wish you would tell the government that. Hello, praise the Lord. The water belongs to God, but in order for it to be piped to your house, you got to have that in order to get this. Hello. Nothing from nothing leaves nothing. If you want something, you got to have some money in this economy. Now, in God's economy, money, I told you, is the lowest form of prosperity. Money is the lowest form of prosperity in God's economy. Luke's Gospel chapter 16, Jesus again teaching about stewardship, and he taught that money was the lowest form of prosperity, meaning that if a person can be trusted in that which is least, they will be trusted in that which is much, meaning money. If a person can't be trusted in the least, if a person is still stressed, struggling, strained, dealing with money, how can Jesus, he said it, how can he trust you with the greater measures of ministry? That's what he said, people. I'm sorry. Amen. That's what he said. If a person don't know how to have whole, not hoard, but have whole and handle their money, he said, I can't allow them to handle the things in the kingdom. And so it is incumbent upon me, the preacher, to preach and teach this. You know why church folk, if church folk have some money, after they get saved, they seem to lose the money that they have. Pause, meditate, think about it. Just think about it. That's why a lot of times rich people don't want to come to church because it seems like they lose their money. And then once they rich and lose their money, how is it that they come to church then? Man, I'm preaching good already. And listen, I thank God. I'm not picking on rich people by no means because many of you are rich. But I'm going to show you. You say, well, what is this? Now, watch this, because I just said, how is it that when the athletes in the entertainment world or movie stars, whoever, and I'm not picking, man, I thank God, because God has given them a heart to be used in such a phenomenal way, the way they have been used even for Hades. Because that's God's heart that he's given unto them. I'm not picking on them, but I'm talking about how is it that seems like so many times the testimony of many stars, as we say stars in the world, once they lose their money, then they come to God. I had a Rolls Royce, and I had a Bentley, and I had this. I had an airplane, and I had that. And I lost it all. And you didn't bring God no money? Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? After they lost all God's money, then they come to God. Hello. Why do you think God said the wealth of the sinner? It is laid up for the just. But he told you who has it. Until they lose it, then they seem to come to God. Now, what am I saying? Because oftentimes preachers, and listen, I'm not talking about preachers that's just preaching money for the sake of money. God forbid, we've had so much of everything. And you got shysters in every profession, including the ministry. And then ethical ministers of integrity, they don't want to really sometimes deal with money matters because the church has got a bad rap because of bad preachers. But the Bible says, now please hear me, and I'm going to go somewhere with this, but the Bible is teaching us, if we understand God's operation, Colossians chapter 2, verse 12, he calls it, listen, the operation of God. He said, this is the operation of God. And choir, the operation of God is not for the preacher just to have the explanation of the text. Meaning that we can explain what the scriptures mean. So that when people leave the church, they say, you know, I understand what this means now. I never saw that before, Reverend. I never saw it until you shared that. That's not the objective of preaching. Yeah. is not for explanation of the text. The operation of God and the objective of preaching is, number one, for there to be an impartation from your preacher. Yes. There is an impartation from your preacher. A revelation from the Father. Impartation from the preacher, revelation from the Father, illumination of the Spirit, that there can be a transformation in us, that there may be a manifestation of Him. Can I say it one more time?
Yes.
See, when the preacher is anointed, the Spirit, Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is up on me. He has anointed me to preach the gospel, number one, to the poor. Why? Now hear this now. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4, Paul says, because my speech and my preaching, it is not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but it's in demonstration of the Spirit and with power, so that the people's faith would not stand in the wisdom of man, but in the power of God. As I'm preaching, see, it is your job to stay focused. It is your job to stay focused. And oftentimes, even as I'm preaching, Jesus said, then the enemy comes immediately to steal the seed of God's word. As I'm preaching, people begin to, do you know what they do? They turn him off. Do you know who turned him off? The broke people. People who are broke. You ain't got no money anyway. We've already lifted the offering. I'm not trying to take anything from you. I'm trying to impart truth unto you. It's the truth that makes you free. You get to talking about money and poor people get funny even in the church. Hello. It's like they turn them off. They turn them off. And they stay broke. Hello. The devil say, just go to sleep now. Just go to sleep now. This is not for you now. This is not for you now. Why? Because you're broke. You don't have no money now. You don't have no money now. And so you sleep on God, you're ignorant. And don't get stuck on it. See, ignorance, it doesn't mean you're stupid. It means you're ignorant. Ignorant mean, watch this, ignorant mean you ignore. The reason why people are ignorant is because they ignore when God says that I'm going to send you a preacher. If you are broke, if you are poor, God says, I'm going to send you some help. Oh, Lord, I need help. I need help. Well, then listen to your preacher when he's preaching. That's why you're broke. Why? Because you're an ignorant person. You ignore. And God says if they're ignorant and they refuse to listen, he said, then let them stay ignorant. He said, I'm sending you some help. And where is the help? It's in the cycle-breaking anointing of your preacher. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to do what? To help the poor get out the hole. To help the poor not be poor no more. To bless the poor. To help lift up the poor that they can see, take, and keep what God has for them. But if they won't listen, then they get stuck in the rut of ignorance. Well, if I had some time. Now, here's the point I want you to see. Here's the point I want you to see. Because this is how faith, watch it, is the exchange for everything in the kingdom. Now, Jesus is teaching this. And this is what Jesus said. He says, you got to have faith in God. That's number one. Now, please hear it. Because faith is the medium of exchange. Whatever you want from God is going to take faith to get it. Please hear me. Faith is the medium, William. Faith is the medium of exchange. The same way that money is the medium of exchange in the economy, faith is the substance. Faith is the medium of exchange. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. It's impossible. So God has dealt. Like you go to Vegas, and they dealt, he's dealt to everyone the measure of faith. It depends upon what you do with the faith mark that he deals you. He's dealt to everybody the measure of faith. Now watch this now, because faith is the what? Medium of exchange. The same way you want this, you got to have that. So it is in the kingdom. See, faith will get you healed. Faith gets you saved. It's faith in the grace of God. But faith is the exchange. See, grace, God has already given you. You will never earn anything from God. That's the worst thing that can ever happen, is that you feel that you've earned something from God. You never earn anything from God. It's all by grace. Amen. Through faith is how you tap into the grace of what God gives. Whatever it is, homes, cars, whatever it is, starting with your salvation, it takes faith to receive what grace gives. If it's healing, it takes faith to receive what grace gives. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
See, faith is the medium of exchange. If your marriage is going to improve, it takes faith, everything. Without it, it's impossible to please God. Now watch this now, because Romans chapter 1, verse 17, write it down. Romans 1, 17, he says, the just shall live by faith. Are you hearing this? The just shall live by faith. So faith is the way that the just is going to live, or saved people are supposed to live. But it's not just faith, but he says, have faith in God. Meaning you can have faith, Al, and it not be faith in God. See, he says, have faith in God. Now I taught before, the thin ice and the thick ice. Here's a man who leaps, let's say he leaps on the thin ice, it cracks, gives way, he goes under. But he leaps on it. He didn't say, you know, I'm a walk on it. He said, normally, and he leaps, it cracks, he goes under. He has what we call, Randy, a faith failure. Now, I always love this example because it helps clarify something for me. And that is, you know, he had a faith failure. But what failed? Was it his faith? Was it because he didn't have faith? No, he said it. He said, I have great faith. And he proved that he had great faith because he leaped on that ice. So it wasn't his faith that failed him. It was what he had his faith in. See, it wasn't the faith. He didn't go tiptoeing on the faith. He leaped on it. It broke. It gave. So it wasn't his faith, Pam, that failed him. It was the object of his faith. But here's somebody that says, I ain't got a whole lot of faith. I don't have a whole lot of faith. I got a little bit of faith. See, because you got to have it. He said, but I got a little bit of faith, but let's say here's a thick ice, 15 feet deep. He don't know it's 15 feet deep, so what does he do? He don't leap on the ice because he don't know about it. He said, I got a whole lot of faith. So he's tiptoeing on the ice. He's walking on the ice. He gets across the other side and says, you know what? That ice sustained and held me. Let me investigate. Cuts down in the ice, discovered that that ice is something like 15 feet deep. What does he do? It's no longer tiptoeing on the ice. He's no longer tiptoeing. He's no longer afraid to walk on that. He's walking on the ice. He's even got a dip when he walks on the ice. I mean, he's strolling on the ice. Mark, he's doing a moonwalk on the ice. I mean, he's got it going on. He's riding on the ice. He's leaping on the ice. Why? Because the more he knows about the object, the greater the volume of his faith becomes. Jesus' mother said, have faith in the right object. It's God. But now here's the point I want you to see. Because the next thing, see, that's the person. The next thing is the principle. Now, watch this now. This is powerful. Whatever you're going to get from God, it's got to be by faith.
Yes, sir.
And God is no respecter of persons. Why is it that some people seem, listen, some nations even seem to have and be doing good while others are suffering and doing bad? God has to send them a preacher that would preach and teach them how to believe God, Valerie. This is what Jesus is teaching. How to believe God. Now watch this, because he says, have faith in God. Then verse 23, for verily I say, or truly I say, unto you that whosoever, watch it, will say unto the mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not, watch it, doubt in his heart. See, there's a revelation of a difference between doubting in the head and doubting in the heart. See, doubt will assail your mind. It's not going to work this, that. But I'm talking about your heart, the heart of the matter. Father, my. You know, the heart, everything, first the natural, afterwards spiritual art. Now, I'm going to give you some revelation here. I'm going to bring some truth around the corner. I hope you have an ear to hear. Because in the natural, whether it's cancer, whether it's sarcoidosis, whatever it is, whatever disease it is, understand it never gets to the heart. Because the body, whatever disease that hit the body send it somewhere else. The agents of the body protects the heart. It sends it somewhere else. You don't get cancer in the heart. It never gets to the heart. And what happens when a person has to have open heart surgery is because their arteries are clogged. Why? Because what was trying to get to the heart, the arteries smothered it. The arteries snuffed it out. Somebody need to hear what I'm saying to you. See, the heart of the matter is the matter of the heart. Because you got to believe with your heart. Jesus said, if you say to the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in your heart, watch it, but shall believe, say believe three times, believe, 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 say I believe.
I believe.
Now this is powerful, because I'm teaching you how to receive. I believe.
I believe.
One more time, I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
See, that's number one. Do you believe? You got unbelieving believers. Now, I told you, first of all, you got ignorance in church. Now, you know that. And all of us are ignorant about something. I'm at the head of the class. I'm ignorant about a lot of things. A lot of things I don't know. But I refuse to be stupid. Ignorance is a commentary on what you don't know. Stupidity is on what you know, but you don't do. Now, you know what's stupid? What is stupid? Now, I'm not picking on nobody because I don't see nobody doing this. But what is stupid for people to get up out of their bed, put on their clothes, get dressed and so forth and so on, and come and turn that preacher off while he's preaching? You could have stayed home and stayed in your bed. You stupid. That's stupid, man. I'm just telling But that's stupid. Nobody made you come. Nobody told you that you had to get up and come. You're getting nothing in terms of, like, you go to your job. You say, I got to go to my job. But you go to church, sit up there so that the preacher can help you and then can turn him off. That's stupid. Because the Bible says how God's going to help your faith is the medium of exchange. And how does faith come? Faith come by hearing. And hearing by the word of God. And who brings your faith? See, he tells you how it comes, but he also tells you who brings it. He says, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach glad tidings and bring your faith to you. That's how your faith is coming. How are you going to get faith? I'm bringing it now. But see, faith comes, but it doesn't stay. It always comes, brother, to take you to where God's trying to get you. See, faith is a carrier. It comes to take you to the place or to the zone of God. It comes to lift you. I come to empower you. I come to speak something to you that enables you to rise and enables you to come and enables you to get into the realm where God is trying to get you. God's trying to take you to a spiritual place where all your needs will be met. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of truth. So if I believe, say it, I believe.
I believe.
Now that's chapter 11, verse 23. You can say to the mountain, now watch this, ministers, watch this. See, people say, well, you know, I believe God can do it. God, one of these days, God's going to do it. God. I believe that there's nothing too hard for God. God's going to do, God's going to do, God's going to do. No, God said, now what are you going to say? See, have faith in God. If you have faith in God, then God, Jesus said, if God say to your mountain, be removed, what are you going to say? See, if I believe, we have the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Faith is released by you speaking something. See, faith is released by you saying something. It's released by you saying. How did you get saved? Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. Man, I'm preaching good stuff to you here. Romans 10, 9 and 10. This is how a person gets saved.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't say that you got to run around the church 10 times saying, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Ain't how you get saved. How do you get saved? You get saved, he tells you, it's so simple, it's so plain. He says, Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess, that say something, yes, with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe. Now the reason why you confess is because you believe. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Then he tells us the combination. For with the heart man believe, and with the mouth confession is made. Say it. For with the heart man believe, and with the mouth confession is made. Jesus said, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe. Why? Because with the heart man believe, and with the mouth confession is made. One more time. With the heart man believe, and with the mouth confession. One more time. With the heart man believe, and with the mouth they go together. If I believe with my heart, then I'm going to release it with my mouth. Yeah, don't patty cake. Go ahead and give him praise. See, what are you saying about your finances? What are you saying about your promotion? What are you saying about your increase? Because faith is released by saying something, but hiring by doing something, and ultimately by giving something. God challenges you to give something, to say something, do something. Now watch this, because I'm going somewhere. I believe, three more times. I believe, I believe, I believe. Now the third word is confess. I believe, confessing. Confessing, say confessing.
Confessing.
One more time.
Confessing.
A little louder.
Confessing.
Now confessing means, it just, when we talk about confession from the Bible context, it don't mean just say whatever you want to say. It doesn't mean you just start making up stuff. See, that's why it's called confess. Homologeo, speak the same thing God says. You have nothing to say if you don't have an ear to hear what he's saying. So it's in my hearing, have faith in God. Then it's in my saying, I say to the mountain or whatever it is. If it's increase, people come from the east, gather them from the west. That's in the Bible. Say to the north, give them up, and to the south to keep them not back. You're releasing your faith. When you give your money, you have to say this next thing. Not only I believe, you wouldn't have gave it if you didn't believe. I believe, but now you got to confess. Watch this. Verse 24, please read it for me. Are you still there? Read verse 24. Therefore, now stop right there. When he says therefore, you already know, hallelujah, I got English majors and Dr. Button, who's an academician and all of that good stuff. So my limited knowledge and understanding, therefore, is always therefore, because what was said before therefore. Is that right? That's why therefore is therefore. So based upon verse 22, 23, Jesus says, therefore, if you understand verse 22, have faith in God. Verse 23, I believe, I believe, I believe in terms of your confessing what God said. Are y'all with me? Then he says, now let's move on to verse 24. Therefore, based upon what I just said, therefore, what things, hello, What things? T-H-I-N-G-S. I like that.
Yes, sir.
The Bible is awesome, isn't it? Yes. God speaking right to your issue. What things? A house is a thing. What things? A car is a thing. What things? A job is a thing. What things? What things? What things? Things. T-H-I-N-G-S. Now watch it. Faith, which is the medium of exchange. Faith is the substance. I'm getting to bring truth around the corner. Faith is the substance of things that you hope for. See, it's the substance of the things. So Jesus said, therefore, what things soever you desire, what you desire is what you just spoke in verse 23. I believe, so I speak to the mountain. That's what you desire, isn't it? For the mountain to be removed, for the cancer to be removed, for the increase in the revenue of my home. I believe, so you confess. You confess. What have you been confessing? Mom ain't have no money. Daddy was a rolling stone. Wherever he laid his hair. I mean, what are you saying? Are y'all going to give me about 3 or 4 more minutes? See, what are you saying? Let me throw this in parenthetically because I'm only going to hit this one time.
Hit it, Bishop.
See, now watch this now. Watch this because I'm only hitting the brother one time. Never talk about things the way they are if it's contrary to what you want. See, don't talk about things the way they are when it's contrary to what you want. Because Jesus just said, you're going to have what you say. And most people keep saying what they have. That's why they keep having what they say. I ain't got nothing out of church, man. This is bad territory. You can't, you know, this is bad territory. Or if I was in Texas where you are, if I was this, if I was that. See, if you talk about things the way they are, that won't make them better. That'll cause you to keep receiving what you got.
That's right.
Mom ain't never have nothing. I ain't never have nothing. How are we going to get anything? There's no jobs out there. There's no. Let them tell that story. There is no jobs out there. What does God say? God says, I shall supply all that you need. God says, I will supply. God says, I got a job for you. God says, I open up doors that no man can shut. What is God saying? What is God saying? Oh, I'm going to lose my job and lose my home. Are y'all going to give me 10 minutes? See, we started in a little storefront church, little storefront. We had 8 members. First service, I think it was 13, 14 members across the street from McDonald's. Cinder block walls, no carpet on the floor, no chairs. Glory to God. We had to believe God for everything. We started with milk crates. Glory to God. But we began to speak what God spoke. Hallelujah. We began to declare what God declared. We begin to say what God say, and God said that you will have whatsoever you say. Whatsoever you say. If God have said it, then you got to start talking. You got to talk like God. You got to walk like God. You got to give like God. And I begin to say what God says. I refuse to be broke. My broke days are over. No more broke for me. I'm out of the broke business. I'm out of the broke business. I begin to say, I'm blessed coming in, blessed going out. I begin to say, I'll be the lender and not the borrower. I'll be the head and not the tail. I'm blessed coming in and blessed going out. What are you saying? See, what do you say? I want you to see this. What are you saying about your business? What are you saying about your home? What are you saying about your husband? What are you saying about your children? Oh, these bad children. They're nothing but a headache. They're nothing but a headache. Oh, these bad children. Bad, 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 bad. I'm going to start saying what God say. Hallelujah. You shape your world by the words that you speak. You got to open up your mouth and begin to say, I'm the head and not the tail. I'm above only and not beneath. I'm blessed coming in and blessed going out. Everything I put my hands to touch, it prospers. It prospers. It prospers. I'm a prosperous man. I'm a giver. Oh, let me have this time, people, please. Let me have a few more moments. We should be out of church by now, I know. But I'm just getting cranked up. Glory to God. See, and listen, when God calls us as pastors and preachers, we have to know how to live. Many times we hinder the church. We hinder the church because we preach the explanation of the text, but there is no revelation from the Father, illumination of the Spirit, no transformation in me, no manifestation of Him. So I don't have an impartation to give. I'm telling you, people, listen, I'm not boasting and bragging on me. I'm saying what Jesus said. And the people, the religious leaders of that day and time, got upset with Jesus. He opened the book and found the place where it was written of him. And he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And he has anointed me to preach the gospel unto the poor. And the people got up, the religious leaders got up and got upset with him and was going to stone him and kill him and said, who do he think he is? See, it's to the anointing. When we know what God's word says, Jeremiah 15, chapter 3, he says, I've given you pastors after my own heart who shall feed you with knowledge and with understanding so that you may increase and multiply. Jeremiah 23, 4, he said that there'll be no lack in my sheep's life. He said, oftentimes in congregation, we just got a poor congregation. We just got a little poor congregation. We don't have much. We don't have much. Well, listen. Listen to me. Please hear me. People sometimes, that big church down there, all those rich people, come on. Now listen to me. I've had to break it down for them, Donald, but I've had people say, see, Bishop, if I had all those people, those rich people like you got, I said, rich people, I said, man, I'm glad you set yourself in agreement and claim it with me. Claim it with me. Claim it with me. You got the community. You got the community saying you're rich. Hey! Got the community saying you're rich. Now let me give you something. Let me give you something. Let me give you something, and I close. I believe you'll see this. I want you to hear this. I want you to hear this, and after this, I'm through. And listen, I don't have time to go back into my testimonies. I know what it is to be without a job. I know what it is to look and be unemployed. I know. When we got saved, I know what it is. But either God is true or it's not true. Either God is true or it's not true. And I begin to confess it. I begin to say it. Why? Because I believe it. See, Isaiah said, listen, this is Isaiah, God's preacher. And he says, and God says, go and ask them, in whom shall believe my report? And then in whom shall my arm be revealed? Who's going to believe my report? See, you got to say, I believe it. And then, Dad, from I believe, you move to confessing. Now watch this, verse 24. Therefore, what things soever you desire. Now, is God playing games with me? What things soever you desire. He said, now when you pray, here's the key, believe. I got the believing part in verse 23. He says, but now I'm closing this thing out. In verse 24, he says, believe, but he connects it, Dolly, to receive. Believe you receive it. See, believe you receive it. He said, believe it. I got it, God. I believe. He said, now add the other part. Confess. Say, I confess. I believe confessing. Come on. I believe confessing. I believe confessing. Confessing what? I receive. Now watch it. See, I believe confessing. I receive. What most people do, they say, I believe. And that's it. God said, no, you got to, the same time you believe it, confess You receive it. Oh, one of these days, God's going to do it. One of these days, this is going to happen. One of these days, that's going to happen. Oh, one of these days, when God said, no, no, no. It's got to be when you say you believe it. You got to receive it. See, he didn't say, know it. He said, believe what? You receive it. Believe you receive it. Can you just believe you receive? Now, watch this. I'm going to close it. This is four things. The preacher got to preach it. See, if the preacher don't preach it, then you can't. That's it. You can't believe it. That's Bible. He's got to preach it. He got to preach it with the power. He got to preach it with the anointing. He's got to preach it so that he can empower you to what? Believe it. See, when you believe something, he has empowered you. He's empowered you. When Peter looked at that crippled man, he says, such as I have, give I unto thee. And read it on out in the book of Acts. It says that he empowered unto that man the ability to believe for supernatural things. That that man received strength in his ankle bones, and he straightened up and he began to walk right. Glory to God. Why? Because he empowered him. Now watch it. So it's got to be preached. It's got to be preached. That's the reason why the devil fight against the preacher preaching it. I'm talking about with ethics and with principle, who's not trying to get something from the people, but trying to impart something to the people. The devil fights against it so hard because that's how the people will be empowered. That's how the arm of the Lord's going to help you with your children. If you believe, if you believe. So it starts off with preaching, then it moves to believing. Then if you believe it, how you really authentically know that you have, you got to believe it and receive it before you physically have it. Now watch it. I said there's four things. Preach it, believe it, receive it, and then you experience it. See, experience it, meaning it manifests. Here it is. Here you're driving in it. Here you're living in it. Here you're doing it. Here you're tasting it. Here you're having it. But you don't get that because faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen until they manifest. And this is good. So faith, believe, receive. You don't have a job, start saying, I receive. I receive my job. I receive my promotion. I receive my house. I receive my college funds. I receive my business. I receive my career. See, you've been believing. It's time to say, I receive it. I receive it. I receive it. When you, listen, when you sow your seed, see, when you give that seed, you got to receive what you are sowing your seed for. I close here. I close here. This way you'll see it. Now watch this. This way you'll see it. Circumstances happens in life. Circumstance or tragedy. What happened in Haiti? I talked to you about it. Circumstance or tragedy. Now watch it. Watch this. Your lifestyle, which is faith, the just shall. Your standard of living. Your standard of living, it should be what God said. Faith. That's what pleases him. Then it never changes. Never. You go from, I can go ahead and close now. You give from, it never changes. That's your life's, the just shall live. And that never changes. Now let me say this, and then we close, and you'll see it. If the just shall live, how? To flip this so you'll see it. In other words, God would say, and God has said, and this is why we live like this. God says, human beings shall live by air. They should live by oxygen. They should live by air. That's how humans are going to live. Now, if you ever stop living off of air, by air, then you stop living. And you can hold your breath, but you can't stop breathing, because God said that's how you're going to live. If you're human, you live by air. If you're fish, you live by water. If you are a Christian, you live by faith. Now, watch this. Watch this. Fred, watch this. I'm closing. Watch this, mother. This is going to help somebody. If that's so, Pam, then he says it this way. Your standard of living by faith never changes. Never. I don't care what the circumstances are. Circumstances in life will change. And just because your circumstances change, lose your job. I hope you realize the job was not what you was living by anyway. Yes, sir. Come on, sir. I done lost my job. I'm not making fun of that. I'm trying to bring a little humor in it so it'll be easy to be entreated. But I lost my job. The job was a resource. God is your source. God is your source. And God has proved it not only in Bible times, but also, mother, in your life, in my life. Now watch this. Now, if the circumstances change, it doesn't mean my lifestyle or my standard change by living by faith. If I stop living by faith, I cut God off from supplying me with what I need. Because now if I stop living by faith, yes, I no longer live by what God says.
Yes, sir.
So God is no longer supplying or supporting my needs.
Yes, sir.
Because if I stop living by faith, I stop believing God, even though I say I believe him, but in my heart I don't.
Good word,
I haven't said that. Here it is. Here it is. Say ER. What does that mean? Huh? Emergency room. Okay. Some of you may have to go there after this. All right. ER. Valerie said, no, there is an emergency room. You better get there as fast as you can. Because, see, some of you need what I'm saying. And there is an emergency, an urgency room that God, zone that God has. Now, watch this. Hear this. The ER. And I'll pick this up later. But watch it now. If I'm a tither, watch it. Because see, Christians, Jesus' grace given, it starts with tithing. We don't pay tithes, we give them. Abraham gave tithes. It said he gave them. So I give them. That's the flow we begin. Now watch it. I'm closing with this. If you are a tither, the same way the heir. If you are a tither, well, let me back it up and say it this way. Because we're talking about sowing and receiving. See, this is how you have to receive faith. If you are a sower, then that's your condition. You never stop being what you are. Now, the question is, are you a sower? Some people say, sure, I sow. No, I didn't ask you that. See, there's a difference between a person who sows and a person who's a sower. What's the difference? The revelation of a difference. You sow occasionally. Every time I feel the Spirit move, I start moving. You hardly ever feel it. When it comes down to how is it that we feel the Spirit moving on other things, but when it comes to giving, we don't feel him. We don't get a feel for it. We get sleepy. We try to turn him off, nod him out. Ignore God. But now here's the point. If you are a sower, see, again, the reason why the garden has weeds is not because it's not because of what the gardener did. It's because of what the gardener did not do. See, the gardener did not sow weed seeds. That's why he's got weeds. He sowed wheat. There's no such thing as I know of weed seeds. You don't buy weed seeds. Weeds are the result of sowing no seed. Weeds are the result of what you didn't do. It's not what you did that brought the weeds up. It's what you didn't give. That's why I got weeds in my garden. It's no seed. No seed. No seed. No seed. Is what causes weeds. Now, if I am a sower and not just I sow. See, sow occasionally is just, you're going to have all kinds of weeds because it's occasional. But if I'm a sower, E-R,
yes, sir.
Put the E-R there.
There
that means I'm a listen, I'm a practitioner of it.
Yes, sir.
E-R meaning I do it. So even when the conditions, when circumstances are in my life that has altered my life but not my lifestyle.
Yeah.
See, I'm still a sower. I'm still a tither. Some people say, yeah, I tithe, but are you a tither? See, I tithe, that means occasionally. I tithe when I get the feeling. I tithe when Reverend moved me. I tithe, but you're not a tither. When you are a tither, your broke days are over. You will never. You'll always live by the economy of God. God will always have the windows of heaven open unto you because you are a tither. But I don't have a job. Just because a person has a job doesn't qualify them as a tither. There are many people with jobs and they don't tithe. To be a tither, meaning for every, listen, for every dollar, how much is that? 10 cents. If all you had was a dollar for that whole year and you gave God 10 cents, you are a tither. You don't stop tithing because you don't have, you don't stop sowing seed. And here is somebody, let's say they gave, listen, based upon how God has blessed them, they gave, their tithe was $1,000 and yours was $1. That person that gave $1,000 didn't give no more than what you gave. A tither is a tither. A tither is a tither. A tither is a tither. And God said, because of what you did, I'll open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer. I'll tell the devil to go to hell. I'll tell the devil to get off of your money. I'll tell the devil to get off of your body. I'll tell the devil to get out of here. Somebody give him praise. Somebody help me bless him. Somebody magnify the Lord with me. Somebody exalt Jesus with me. Hallelujah. 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 Now I want everybody to stand to your feet. Lift up your hands with me. When we leave here, we're wide open for what God is doing and what God wants to do. We are part of a river of life. We're in the main flow of God. We're in the move of the Holy Ghost. Come on, lift up your hands and say after me, I'm in the river of God.
I'm in the move of God.
I'm moving from here to there. My faith is taking me somewhere. I believe. Confessing, I receive. I believe. Confessing, I receive. I believe. Confessing, I receive. All of my needs are met according to God's glory. I believe. Confessing, I receive. I'm healed according to God's promise. I believe. confessing I receive. I'm standing on top. All things are under my feet. Jesus is the head of the body. And all things are under his feet. I'm in his body. Therefore, all things are under my feet. I believe, confessing I receive. I speak to the mountain. Doubt, fear, unbelief be removed from my life, because I believe, confessing I receive. I'm blessed coming in. I'm blessed going out. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. I believe, confessing I receive. And I give you praise for it, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 All this week, all this week, all this week, whatever it is, the Holy Spirit will start bringing up other stuff, things in your life. Hallelujah. Just things in your life. You call it into your ministry. You call it into your life. You begin to say, I believe, confessing I receive. I believe, confessing I receive. Pastors, if it's members that God has for your church, then you begin to say it. I believe, I confess, I receive. Whatever the budget is for the ministry, God's not trying to raise the budget of the church, but elevate the level of the faith of God's people. I believe, confessing I receive. I believe, confessing I receive. We have had so many testimonies coming in terms of the manifestation of things already this year, because that's the season. This is the time. There is a grace. There is an anointing, cycle-breaking anointing. And you're carrying that anointing. Say, I believe.
I believe.
Confessing, I receive.
Confessing, I receive.
I'm carrying it now.
I'm carrying it.
Yes, go ahead. Say, I'm carrying it now. What is it? A cycle-breaking anointing. Go ahead. A cycle-breaking anointing. I got a cycle-breaking anointing. The cycle is broken. A cycle-breaking anointing. A cycle-breaking anointing. A cycle-breaking anointing. And people, when it, as it's working in your life, there will be people God bring you around. People such as that don't have jobs or whatever it is, but because of the cycle-breaking anointing up on your life, there will be a manifestation of him, and they will be blessed. They will be blessed. They'll be drawn to you like metal to a magnet because of the cycle-breaking anointing. One more time, say it with me, I believe.
I believe.
Confessing, I receive.
Confessing, I receive.
Cycle-breaking anointing.
Cycle-breaking.
Whatever I put my hands to, I declare God's decree that it shall prosper. My children shall prosper. My family shall prosper. Generations to come. Because I believe, I receive a cycle-breaking anointing. One more time, giving praise.
Please join me as we confess verses 13 through 15 of the 92nd Psalm. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. To show that the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. If you're in need of prayer, salvation, rededication, or church membership, counselors are standing by to take your call at 254-777-6292.